I'm sure you have lots of questions in the future on this, and me too. So let's go. Sorry, explain. The second speaker is, Sarra Saad, A M Saad, Alam Ahmed, and Sufian Osman, A M Osman. And they are going to present on combating desertification in Sudan, experiences and lessons learned, and other lessons. Thank you. Please, Sarra.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our presentation is compact on desertification in Sudan, experiences and lessons learned. It's a joint research done by me, Sufian, and Alam, and other two colleagues, as Adil, Sid Ahmed, and Professor Ahmed Duma from Sudan. They couldn't make it to come to Geneva. So I appreciate their help in writing this paper. Sudan is from Africa country, and now the problem of desertification is very huge. As you can see in the map, in the right side, Sudan, after separation of the southern part of the country, 72% of the country total area is classified as desert, with low and medium soil fertility. Currently, we are facing problem of agricultural production in Sudan. Here it is serious. And from the map here, we are monitoring the desertification. As you see in the pink color, the desertified area, and the blue and yellow color is areas under threat. The challenge now is how can we invest this land? This is a real problem now in Sudan. And land degradation are among central problems for sustainable development of dry land ecosystem, and now is a challenge, how can we invest in these areas? I don't know what about this slide, Selma. I think it's left. Desertification, I think the map, they are lost from the slide. I'm not sure. We can continue. Desertification is always accompanied with shortage of rain. And rainfall is becoming increasingly scarce and unavailable for Sudan's Sahel belt. This trend is likely to continue. On this basis alone, large tracts of the Sahel will be severely impacted by declining food productivity over the next generation and beyond. Droughts and insufficient rain are characteristics of Western Sudanese territories, also in other northern parts, northern Darfur and Kordofan. Over the past 100 years, there have been 5 periods of prolonged drought in the region. 2 of them have happened in the last 20 years. In these areas, the average precipitation ranges from 100 to 600 millimeters per year, which with its lower limit poses a high probability of serious adverse consequences in the agricultural livestock sectors. I think we've lost some of the maps here. So what did Sudan do to tackle this problem? Seriously, Sudan since 1940s took a very long effort in combating desertification. In 1944, they established report of conservation committee that established that soil degradation and desertification was mainly due to the misuses of land resources rather than a result of climate change. So Sudan highlighted since 1940s that the climate change issue. From 1972 to 1976, the National Committee for Combating and Drought Desertification was established, and with the purpose of preparing the studies and solutions to the problems of desertification and droughts. And further, in 1979, Minister of Agriculture was assigned a part-time coordinator to follow up desertification control projects. Together with the National Bureau for Drought Control and Desertification was established under supervision of Minister of Agriculture, and a decision was taken as Permanent Council of Desertification. In 1980s, UNDP also provided technical and financial support, also designed as the Office for Coordination of Desertification Programs. And they hold 4 regional workshops to raise awareness and to consult the phenomenon of gentrification and how to address these problems. And further, in 1986, established the Relief and Reconstruction Commission that was affiliated to the Ministry of Agriculture. Also, sectarian fund was raised. In 1988, another council of ministers decided to establish a central ministry of refugees and relief affairs and included its structure and administration to combat gentrification. And further, in 1991, they established a drought and gentrification coordination unit, that's NDDU. 1993 also established the first GIS unit, and proudly to announce this unit is affiliated to the National Center for Research in Sudan, where I work. And the responsibility was to technical support from European Union to monitor the certification and hazard of climate change. In 2001, our organization for agricultural development also coordination project with Ministry of Agriculture in Sudan, and they open commission of 2 national recruitment to UNDP work. Again, 2002, National Action Program was prepared by Ministry of Agriculture together with United Nations. And 2009, the certification law was provided by the government. 2015, another legislation was done by the president that certification is a serious problem and should be taken seriously, even from the high-ranking person in the country. 2016, Secretary General of the National Council to Combat Gentrification was appointed. And 2017, also a National Council to Combat Gentrification was included and established in the Ministry of Environment, and I'm one member of this National Council. We started, and the government did so many effort to tackle gentrification, but still, this is the current situation now. What's going on? Since 1944, we are talking about gentrification in Sudan and the hazard of climate change and food security. This photos was taken by my colleague, and in the right side map, this is a research station called the Rawakib Research Station. It's just 40 kilometers western of Khartoum, the city of Sudan, and we are taking responsibility to do research there to stop sand movement. Unfortunately, we failed. Sand is covering everywhere in Khartoum, keeps on moving towards the cities. Northern part is completely deteriorated. Even the soil characteristics completely change. We have another new zone from 30 centimeters, 40 centimeters in soils around northern states, the agricultural sector, another state. Newly established soils transported from western part of Africa and cannot be used for agricultural production. So gentrification now, I think, is the first problem that should be considered in Sudan. What can we do as partnership with private sectors? Some private sectors from other countries, not Sudanese, from Arab countries, they invest in these areas, but they have money. Sudan cannot invest in these areas. So what can we do? We need to secure food for 32 million people in Sudan. Concluding remarks, we concluded that serious attempts were made many years ago to formulate regulations and legislations and to coordinate with international and regional agreements. Despite these efforts, desertification is still defined as the major threat to sustainable development and human lives. Many conclusions and lessons emerge from the previous experiences of government, NGOs, civil societies, and private sectors in implementing desertification programs in Sudan. The analytical review of Sudan's gentrification policies showed a lack of the intersectoral approach that integrates forestry activities and land use into the social, economic, and developmental process in the country. They also lacked linkage to other sectors that use and actually compete for the available natural resources. And therefore, facts should be implemented to stop sand movement and improve soil quality. This is in addition to the interpretation of research results that deal with modeling, drought, and control, and we go back or we go back to the forest. And in the right hand, this is a book. It's published by my father, who was deceased in 2008. He was an environmentalist. He established the Environment Society in Sudan. He wrote a book in Arabic, Atlal Tahta Rimal, Am Tariq Al-Awda Ila Al-Ghaba, and English, Ruins Under the Sands or Back to the Forest. He's the first one who how to monitor the problem identification and brief in one sentence, either we take serious measures or we'll go back to the forest again. And still the road, just from our research station in western part of Sudan, of Khartoum, still we have a long road paved with sands, but still some trees around here and there, and we keep on doing our research to combat desertification. And thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, this is it's not a new, I suppose, problem for Sudan or other countries. As you said, your father has already worked on them. But let us see if you have got any burning question, please. Thank you.
From Sudan myself, I give myself this permission to ask this question. Okay, so you've introduced a number of measures like teams and units and since 1940. What happened to the Green Belt? What happened, which it started, it was there sometime in Sudan. So what are the measures in place that has been put outside committees and policies to combat the desertification in Sudan? Agricultural policies, Green Belt, and political buy-in.
It's a good question. If you mean the Green Belt, that was built in the 1960s. Yeah, I think Sudan was the first country who focused on problem of Green Belt and reducing temperatures. It does not exist anymore, as you know that, yeah? This is a serious problem. The problem is that the decision makers, sometimes they don't coordinate environmental problems with researchers and decision makers. Yeah, this is a problem in Sudan. Now they realize that the only way out to secure food to Sudanese population is to invest in desert, because we only left with desert. Now they start thinking of Green Belt. Now it's done in Africa, in Sahel region. It's organized with other African countries. But our Sudan is, we need local solutions. Yeah, it's urgent. Now, especially the increasing temperature is accompanied with desertification and sand movement. Temperature is changing in Khartoum now, or in Sudan. We have two agricultural seasons, winter season and summer season. Winter season starts from November to March, and temperature should be from 25 to 29, and summer from 30 to 35 or 40 maximum. Now temperature in winter season reach up 40. That's why the farmers forget about for cropping other winter crops like wheat, for example. The government shifted. Instead of solving the problem to reduce temperature and implement a Green Belt, they import wheat from outside country with hell of dollars every year to fill the gap between demand and supply. Yes, the problem is serious. We need intersectoral approach, coordination between different researchers, decision makers, and it should be done so fast, because now we're importing everything outside Sudan, even the vegetables. Thank you for the question.
Yes, we have another question from Nahala. Yeah. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, Sarra, Sufyan, and Prof. Alam for this important subject. Effort taken by Sudan in combating desertification from governmental and private sectors. What do you think about the role of research institution as integrated part of this problem?
Yes, we as researchers, we have the ideas and scientific knowledge. How can we stop sand? Yeah. Different methods, scientific methods can be used. The modeling, application of drought, resistant crops. But we are not decision makers. Yeah. Yeah, this is a problem. We need the relation between the private sector is another issue. Now we should start with the first step. Call the Sudanese researchers who are in each research institutions and take our idea and ask for the private sector to apply what we have done. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right, thank you. Anyone else, please? Just last question. Yeah, thank you.
Good morning. Please excuse my voice. I have a question. You pointed out that there was a lack of intersectorality. I've seen through the slides that the issue has gone through the Minister of Agriculture, the Minister of Environment. How has the matter gone through one agency to another and brought up no intersectorality? Is the work done in silos? And how do you plan on breaking those silos and have an intersectoral solution or response to that?
Question, but I think if I said the question correctly, you asked about you have Minister of Environment, Agriculture, the relation between them. Yes. Yes, happily enough that last year they established the Certification Council under the President, which is good. And members represented from all ministers, Environment, Agriculture Ministry, from research centers. I am a member of this council. They started this late. Although they declared the problem of certification in the 1940s. 1917, they established the Certification Council. It took many years to establish, to realize this coordination, importance of coordination, but it's done lately.
So please remember, if we all help and do a little bit, it will make a big difference.